In my big dream imagining, we get to distill the deepest stories and the truths that come out of community and out of history. When we have our voices heard and have our messages heard, we become leaders. Yetsup Oweliel, Siaya, Siem, Sialakwa, Ich Imachne Eten, Antha Jada-Gabrielle Pape, Antha Wu Wasselwat. Welcome to the Drawing Wisdom video podcast. We're in season 3. This is episode 3, where we dive into a conversation with Jenna Breuer. Introduce yourself as you'd like to be known in this conversation.
My name is Jenna Breuer. I am a visitor to the West Coast from the Eastern Gate, from Maniwaki, through adoption, through displacement. So I was made in the East and exported to the West. My work is as a registered psychiatric nurse. And I've worked in our community here in Vancouver for 24 years now, nursing and seeing all kinds of interesting changes and evolutions of how we are looking after each other in Vancouver.
You said working with our people, but it's not just our people, it's actually in a really specific area. I wonder if you want to talk about that.
Sure. Becoming a nurse was never a goal for me. I was the kid in school who picked on the girls who wanted scholarships and wanted to wear white Crocs. Like, that's not who I was. I don't want to say I was a bad kid. I was a kid who did bad things and barely scraped through and continued doing those things for a while. And then I stopped doing those things and started living a bit differently. And one day, when I was trying to figure out, what I wanted to be when I grew up, discovered nursing. But there was something about it that felt really kind of clinical. At the time, I didn't have that word, right? But it felt mechanical and clinical. But the idea of working with people in a realm of wellness, something about that worked for me. And then I discovered what psychiatric nursing was. And that instantly felt like home. Instantly. Once I realized what the difference was between psychiatric nursing versus more medicalized nursing.
What is the difference?
The difference is a bit more of a holistic approach to wellness. It's not about saying, Mrs. Jones, you're not taking your insulin and you're gonna lose your toes and it's not that. It's like, hey, what's the barrier? Oh, you can't get to the pharmacy because you have a mobility problem. Oh, you watched your mother take insulin for 20 years and you're scared of it. Oh, and then working with that, it's working with a different part of the person, but recognizing that that is part of the whole of the person.
Do you think that that's what all psychiatric nursing is, or do you think that you bring something more or different or alternate or of our people?
I think that there's a lot of private schools now that sell degrees to create nurses, and we do need nurses who have a textbook way of being, maybe, and a very clinical approach. Do I think that everybody comes with a kind of an understanding that, you have to treat the whole part of the person? No, I don't think every nurse comes with that. Where does it come from? I also don't know that. That ability to sit with a person and really hear beyond what the need is on paper. And I don't know where that comes from. I like to think ancestors. How do you describe that, right? Like, sometimes in an interaction with a person, it's kind of almost like theirs are talking to yours. Mm-hmm. And there's another conversation happening. And it's like, well, let's talk about what's really happening here. There's something very fascinating about working with people who are experiencing life in multiple ways, whether that's through psychosis or through, you know, through trauma or terror, or through being abused by Western medicine. Right? It's and when you're able to you have the education, you have the textbook education here, and you bring that with you, but to be able to kind of put that down for a minute and listen. It's a skill set. Yeah.
I feel like there's something in there that is like, it brings us back to an indigenous way of caring. So when you call it an ancestral way or an ancestral or relational way, you know, our people never cared for each other before there was Europeans here, before there was the violence of colonialism. Our people didn't care for each other as slivers of ourselves, right? My whole self came to your whole self. And so all of that, we never said, oh, I'm going to go practice my culture. I'm going to go, you know, do canoeing, or I'm going to go pray, right? Like if you got in a canoe, it was because you were going somewhere. It wasn't a cultural thing, it just was. Yeah. And if you were, and everything was prayer, everything was ceremony. To get into your canoe brought us to ceremony. So the same would be of working with someone and caring for them, that I'm not just going to care for, you know, your sore wrist. I'm going to check in with what's happening with your wrist, and who was or wasn't there when your wrist was injured, and what's my role in it. And so that to me feels like an indigenous way of knowing. And so when someone comes to sit with you, first of all, there's a huge trust in each other, that you are both bringing your full selves. Right, there's a whole, like, it's always an honor to be in those conversations. And as soon as we forget that this is a real honor, and we just think this is a job, or I know more than this other person about themselves, I think then we're no longer working in a good way, right? You also sort of brought forward the notion of people are working on lots of levels. And I think for the reason I asked you about what's happening, you know, do you think it's a you thing, or do you think it's like a, you know, psychiatric nurse thing? Or because I know that there is a lot of conversation about being trauma informed, and trauma informed equals saying certain things. Mm-hmm. But actually, you can follow the script of a trauma-informed interaction, and the script doesn't make it trauma-informed. It's actually, there's an underlying humility and love that makes it trauma-informed. And we have to be so careful, like, whose trauma am I speaking to? Am I speaking to your trauma or to my trauma? And if I'm speaking to your trauma, is there just a part of me that's curious, or does this need to be on the table right now? Mm-hmm. And is it of service to you if I ask you about your trauma? Quite often, no. Right. Because we're just going to leave it hanging. We're not actually even going to soothe your nervous system. I think the work you do is very, very complex. But I also know that something in it must heal parts of you, because you stay there.
You're right, and you know, when you're talking about, you know, not taking the lid off the box, it's because under the guise of the letters behind my name and the system that I work within, I don't have the resources to put the lid back on safely sometimes, most times. I mean, it's a whole conversation about our healthcare system imploding. You really have to use critical thinking and kind of dance carefully, and be aware that you're not leaving a person stripped down, because that's unethical and it's unkind. And you're right about You know, trauma-informed care is just kind of this new phrase that's been coined. I think our people have always done that. It's just that we have a title on it now. And you're right, I do see people who can read off that script backwards and forwards. I was taught once that it was interesting teaching about, you know, keeping your mouth clean for the people and keeping your mouth clean for the Chinupa. And then the teaching that came the next night was, those swear words aren't ours. They have no medicine here. It's the intention of the word you use that is the energy. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I'm allowed to swear here, but you know, if you tell someone to F off, there's not an entity judging me for that. But what was my intention? Was that anger? Mm-hmm. Was that my arrow that I'm directing at someone? Mm-hmm. Or am I saying it in a joking and loving way? The pipe's not gonna judge me on that. It's about the energy of the words. And it's the same thing in interactions with people. You know, when people are scared or in pain or hurting or just tired. Yeah. So many people in this city are tired. We're just tired. We're all just tired. You know, I'm really blessed to have a team that I work with, and they're an incredible team. It's all women. And I just say, you know, come with love and your words will get through. Just come with love. And you can set a boundary. You can be direct. You can be really clear, really transparent. Come with love. Mm-hmm. Keep everyone's dignity intact in the room. And say what needs to be said. And I think, to be honest, that's kind of part of my bundle, is being the straight arrow. And sometimes looking at a person and going, this isn't working for you. Mm-hmm. Let's find something that works for you differently. Mm-hmm. You know, and just saying it, right? Mm-hmm. Like, but that also comes from years of being able to talk to people, right?
You have to practice being direct. It's not something everyone can do. So the nature of being in right relationship means we've got to really have our own level of self-awareness raised and clear, right? And looked after. Yeah. And that's some of that boundary work.
You have to kind of know how you show up. And that's constantly changing. We're humans. We're designed to change. I know what I show up with today that might change, and it's the ability to kind of just be the straight arrow and then the soft landing. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's kind of part of the work that I do right now, you know, working with women who are reducing substance use or exploring abstinence from substance use, and kind of being that straight arrow, but also the soft landing. Someone taught me once that truth without compassion attached is cruelty. So you can be a truth teller, mm-hmm. but if you don't have compassion there, sometimes what's the point? What's the point to see? The truth is right in front of you. You're going to hurt that person. Mm-hmm. So why? And sometimes also, I don't have a different way of saying it. Sharp knives cut cleanest. Yeah. This isn't working for you. Let's find a different way of making it work. Do you want to find a different way of making, like, you know, being the soft landing too? Mm-hmm. But it's like, you know, let's say what's here.
I guess what I hear in that is that you're not prescribing the outcome. You're observing, this is not working. And that's where the compassion is, and that's where the love is, right? Show up with love, arrive with love. That mm-hmm. I can see this isn't working, you're showing me this isn't working. I'm not going to tell you what to do, but what do you want to do? What are some other pathways we can be in conversation about? Mm-hmm. And also recognizing those substances that people, whether they want to reduce use or abstain from, Those substances have been an incredibly important coping and keeping people alive. Without those, many people would choose to end their life. And there is so much to be grateful for that they've been able to choose substances.
Yeah, to really honor the way a person has coped and navigated through their life and stayed alive. Mm-hmm. It's an honor to be in a position where you can have those conversations with people. Mm-hmm. And sometimes coping, a way of coping, burns itself out, spins its own gears, and it's time to find a different way of coping. And that might not be abstinence, that might not, it might be a different substance, it might, whatever it evolves into. But I think, you know, in that clinical frame, like, we forget to recognize the resilience. Like, nurses are trained to find the illness, but what about finding the resilience? What about finding the wellness? Working with the wellest part of the person. Everybody has it. Everybody has it. It's just, things are so complex right now. Mm-hmm. In our city, trying to serve people, mm-hmm. It's complex. There's a lot of barriers. There's a lot of gaps. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the answers are. I have no idea. Mm-hmm. I have thoughts about, you know. Yeah.
Well, that is part of being able to see people as whole people, is that when people are really in duress and looking for supports, that shows us some robustness and some resilience and some creativity on their part. But also it shows incredible determination that in a city that we don't have resources. And we can say this is a country-wide thing. We can say this is a continent-wide thing. We could talk about, you know, the colonial project, and this is a worldwide issue. But if we just look at Vancouver and then we actually bring it into the neighborhood of the downtown east side where we're really talking about, you know, we're actually talking about an incredibly under-resourced neighborhood that is full of some of the most beautiful teachers, and the people who live in that neighborhood, regardless of where they come from or how they've arrived there or the way that they are living their lives, they are some of our best teachers. Yes. Because they're showing us what it's like to be loyal to each other and community, and they're showing us there are many ways to live through colonial pain. And that isn't to paint it with, you know, just a beautiful brush. Mm. But actually, we choose to not look at that beautiful, you know, brush stroke. And we choose to just see it as a blight. Mm. But actually, some of my most hopeful conversations are with people who live and connect in the downtown east side, because they're the most creative.
Yeah.
And there where I see over and over and over an incredible loyalty to each other that we don't see in other areas.
Right. I was having a conversation not long ago where, you know, we're talking about, oh, broken systems. It's a broken system. It's a broken system. Without sounding kind of tinfoil hat about it, right? Too, right? Like too conspiracy theory about that. Like, I don't know where or on what level or how that mechanism happens, but this is not, mm-hmm. It's intentionally broken. It's mm-hmm. contrived. Mm-hmm. I've been working in, you know, the various arenas of like addictions, harm reduction, infectious disease care for 24 years. And I'm telling you, it's not that we've missed the mark. It's that we chose not to hit the mark. Like, there's a difference there. And when you see how the community continues to survive that resilient energy, that comes out of the downtown east side, and you feel it, it's palpable. Mm-hmm. This is not about a community with poor coping. This is about a community with incredible coping and incredible resilience and strength, and like you say, creativity. Just continuing to be subject mm-hmm. to something's contrived somewhere. Mm-hmm. You just can't convince me anymore.
Well, I think we've had a really clear demonstration in the last, however long ago we observed it as a worldwide pandemic, right? Like, what's it, 3 years now?
It's such a blur.
But yeah. A little while ago we, you know, entered the pandemic, and boy, did things move fast. And we mm-hmm. saw, you know, the ability for things to change and shift, and like, and it came from the muckety mucks at the very top, and everybody followed suit, and you know, or like we can't look after this one small community.
Right.
And I really think there it is. It's just right there. We will prioritize whatever we want. And we're shown every single day the value of Indigenous lives and the value of people engaged in substance use. And you know, like there's real small things, like you hear it referred to as, you know, lifestyle choices mm. instead of people's lives.
Like, right.
Like those are, yeah, like really, really harmful. But yeah, we're choosing to miss the mark on this.
Absolutely. What was so interesting at the beginning of the experience of COVID was watching how the red tape fell away. Mm. It just in small systems. Like, you know, like I was noticing it in small systems that lots of examples, but like the way of doing things, like with my employer or in the community, or lots of red tape went up too, right? No doubt. But a lot of middle people, we use the term middle men, I'll say middle people, we didn't need them. It was like this, it's like remove that middle step and we need to get from A to Z, and there's no room in between, and it needs to be done quickly. And how efficiently some things did function, mm-hmm. some, mm-hmm. when we did that. Mm-hmm. And it really made you kind of, for me, I kind of had to really reassess and realign and just sit back. I sat back and watched, and I'm like, oh, interesting. Mm-hmm. So I don't need to make 6 phone calls, 3 faxes, and 2 emails to get this person a prescription anymore.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So why are we doing this again? And that, I'll tell you, that neighborhood is a billion-dollar industry. It's an industry. You walk up and down the street and you look at every service, every employee, every dollar that is spent on the nurses, the outreach workers, the maintenance, the, you know, upkeep, everything. Mm-hmm. And how many of those dollars just trickle down onto the sidewalk? Like, mm-hmm. not a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot. And I'm just, I think, do I sound jaded? Probably. But I probably am a bit. But like, you gotta wonder how it was so quick. Certain systems were made highly efficient very quickly, but we're still having conversations about nurses prescribing safe supply.
Yeah.
We're doing it. But we're missing the mark,
yeah.
again, and it's because why?
It's, I think, what in the world of anti-racism we call it a detour, right? Let's not talk about the actual thing. Let's just like go decon over here and talk about this, right? And it's so let's not look at the underlying pieces that are creating the distress and the humiliation and the pain in the community. Let's decrim this amount of drug supply, you know, for youth. But what does that do for toxic drugs? Like, so we're just detouring all over the place, which is a bit of a make work project.
That's a gaslight. It's a community yeah. gaslight, isn't it? It's like,
yeah.
Oh no, we're doing really good at this.
Yeah.
You're fine.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's no care in that. And that's, I think, like where I really struggle in conversations about system and conversations about our people and where there is that intersectionality. I really, like, in the deepest place of me, I love our people. Just fiercely and loyally and more than anything, I love our people and the things we carry. You know, our ways of being in relationship and the teachings. And I love our pain. Not because I think we deserve it or but I think I love it because we've never stopped being us. And then when we have the intersection of what is the system doing, the system represents a much broader scope and it doesn't love our people. Mm-hmm. We are not even human. And so when we, you know, we bring that all the way back to, you know, the Roman Catholic Church and the doctrine of discovery and the very, you know, legitimizing of dehumanizing our people. And that's what we're still enacting over and over and over. And that's where, like, the conversation for me, it always gets really difficult because one of them is really theoretical and like, what can we do to, you know, and then the other part is like, we know exactly what to do.
Yes. Just leave us alone.
Yes.
Right? Like, I've had that, you know, it's, again, it's that, you know, sometimes things just come out of me, but it's like, just leave us alone. We're fine.
Yeah.
We can handle this. There's conversations that we still are having amongst ourselves about how we can come to the table, recognizing the internal lateral violences that do happen in our community. But leave us alone. Mm-hmm. We can handle this, you know, and but there's just but it's still even in saying we can care for our own children, we can care for our women, we can help our men do their work now. Mm-hmm. We're at that place where the men can start picking up their bundles and doing their work. It's starting. We know how to look after our elders. It's like still asking permission. Right? It's like, can you please give us this? It's still this asking permission thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. How do you, I don't know.
Yeah, you know, and that piece about, sure, there'll be lateral violence. When we look at what lateral violence is, right? Like lateral violence is when we have an anger at a system, when we are angry at something that is out of our control, and we can't lash out and say, oh, you, colonialism. But what you can do is marginalize that anger in yourself and then lash out at someone who is no threat to you.
Right.
Right? And that's what lateral violence is. And so, of course, we're going to have lateral violence because we're all angry at the system. And so, until we have some level of sovereignty that we are governing and where we're no longer asking for handouts.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I think you're right. Leave us alone is one way of saying it, and go home. You know, I think it's something that every non-Indigenous person should do is go home. And
yeah.
I'm not against people just going home forever, but also I'm not prescribing that. I'm saying go home and feel what it's like to walk in the homelands and the motherland of your ancestors. Just see what that feels like.
Yes. Find what's yours. Yeah. I've had that conversation with a lot of people.
Yeah.
You know, like, oh, well, where are you from? And, oh, you know, and you know, like we've talked about, like the romanticizing of, mm-hmm. of you know, Indigenous North America, and it's a whole nother conversation, mm-hmm. isn't it? But like, you know, and then you ask, you know, a settler, where are your people from? Oh, we're from, you know, somewhere in Eastern Europe. You know, I'm like, oh, there's some powerful witches in there. Those are the women walking out of the forest with the reindeer horns on their head. Find what's yours. Mm-hmm. So you don't take what's mine. So we don't have kids wearing headdresses at Coachella. Find what's yours. Mm-hmm. You have powerful, it doesn't matter where in the world you come from. Mm-hmm. You've at some point, if you can kind of get a little bit further back, past colonization and past,
sure.
contact, if you can get past that and through that and find your grandmothers, the ones you'll never meet, the ones that are 1,000 years old, you're going to find powerful medicine in there too.
Mm-hmm. Like what you're actually talking about is belonging, right. And that when we don't belong, when we don't nurture the belongingness, we go and we take from others because we don't have a sense of it, and so we don't understand what that might be like, that we're taking, that we're extracting. And I think if people were to go home and feel belongingness and feel love and reverence and feel belonging to a land, they may come back here and go, okay, I'm going to show up in a different way.
Right.
I've stopped using the term settlers. There's something I haven't quite unpacked it fully, mm-hmm. but there's something about when we say settler, I feel like we are removing the violence of the story.
Like you're settled in.
Yeah.
Like you found your niche, you found your place to be, and it's comfy for you.
Yeah, and I think that's the language in early textbooks that like we had in grade 3 and 4.
Right.
It was like the settlers came and they didn't come, they invaded. And they didn't settle the land. They destroyed it and are destroying it, and they're occupying it still. But so if we say colonial settler, I like it. I can like it. Doesn't erase the violence. Yeah. Tells a more truth. But I'm always wrestling with what do we call non-Indigenous people? And I think I also pull apart the threads of that, and it isn't. You know, there are black people who are descendants of enslaved people, so they are stolen and remain on stolen lands. And so that's a different, they're not settlers. Mm-hmm. And refugees, mm-hmm. who have fled from the same colonialism that they come to here, they are not settlers. But then it's those people who are like, oh, it's an old immigration story, and like, meh. I don't want to call those people settlers anymore.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Language just keeps changing, doesn't it? As we keep trying to unpack, we keep finding new words. And like you talk about ways of knowing, I think we just, it's here.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have a word for it. Mm-hmm. I don't know, maybe we do. Maybe some culture, I don't know, some nations have a word for it, but it's just here and it's an understanding.
The word that we have where I come from is Junitam. And Junitam is it's a description of a missingness, and it's a lack of, it's a povertiness. There is no story, there is no history, there is no color. It's Junitam is like, it's a missingness, and that's the term, and there's no judgment in it. I think the language changes when we're ready to see it.
Mm.
So how do we push en masse for people to be ready to see the many truths of our people?
That's energy medicine.
Yeah.
How do we push en masse? We have been.
That's true. That is what we do.
Maybe it's prayer. Maybe it's prayer energy. I don't know. I I mean, that's pretty rainbows and unicorns of me to think that, you know, if we all just globally pray, like, but I don't know.
I don't know if it's rainbows and unicorns. I think there is real power in prayerfulness, because it calls on us to live in a different way. And if you are somebody who prays, I would like to think that there is humility, because you recognize there's something bigger than us.
I think it's kind of what we have at the end of the day. Yeah. Like I've often, you know, loved ones struggling, that you know there's really not much you can do here. You can always pray. Mm-hmm. It's like the one of the few things they didn't take from us. Mm-hmm. And that colonization hasn't taken from others as well. And I kind of don't care who you pray to or how you do it.
Sure.
Just do it. There's an energy there that heals and that shifts.
Yeah. We don't pray the same. There isn't one way to pray as Indigenous peoples, right? Like, yeah. We pray with water, we pray with different plant medicines, we pray with fire, like, we pray with laughter. Yeah. There isn't one way. In your years of working in the downtown East Side and with people showing up in lots of ways, can you share a story about something or someone that really taught you a lot and how that came to you?
So many. Very new to the work, a new grad. And then I came with like the intention of trying to figure out what I'd learned in textbooks versus that way of knowing, and how am I gonna show up to do my work? Like how do I wanna be in this role? Very, very new. And sitting with a man who was really adamant about making sure that I knew about how he had ridden in on the back of a whale and had spoken to the fish. And he also at that time felt that he was Poseidon. He was an Indigenous man. I was like, well, maybe. What we would say is a really kind of lot of psychotic material. Mm-hmm. We would say racing thoughts. We would say delusional content. We would say all these things. We'd say a flavor of paranoia, all these things. And it was a long conversation, and it was circular, and it was just kind of me sitting and nodding my head and listening and kind of realizing halfway through that, no, like, you need to listen. Mm. And listening and listening and listening, and then saying, you know a lot about the ocean. And watching this man just fall into himself and say, I've been a fisherman of the West Coast for almost all my life. My family are fisher people. We come from the fish people. My family have lived in the villages. Fish is our life. And then he went back to, and when I was Poseidon, blah, blah, blah. But in that moment, mm-hmm. there's always something. Mm-hmm. You know, people can be really saying stuff that doesn't make sense. If you listen, there's always that grain of sense in there. And so the lesson for me in that was to find the well part of the person, to listen with intent, mm-hmm. And to not just kind of disregard someone who's not making sense as gobbledygook. It's not. There's a grain of something in there. The way that man's, I'll never forget it. It just imprinted on me. The way his face changed, mm-hmm. body changed. Mm-hmm. It was like a 20-second shift, but he was telling me the truth. Mm-hmm. You know, he was from the West Coast and he knows the ocean. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, and I believe you. Because I see you are, I got it. Mm-hmm. Tell me more about the back of the whale then. You know, because he just kind of like faded away. Okay, that was like really early on. That was a real there was a teaching in there somewhere about honoring a person's experience. You're a human being with life experience. And without sounding like too esoteric, but like there's something about the energy of people who are in two worlds at once, or who are experiencing the world differently than what I'm experiencing. When the two of us are in the room and we are experiencing the room differently, there's something about the energy of that. I wonder sometimes if when people are in that place, even though I've seen people really terrified, really scared, if maybe you're not just a little closer to Creator in that moment.
Well, you know, it strikes me that when you're, like if you and I are sitting here, we're having this conversation. We also, I think, bring our ancestors in, and they're here too, but we're not actively, they're not active participants in a conscious way for us. But if I'm in two worlds, right, and I'm working on a lot of levels, I'm holding down a couple of different conversations, and then that means that you're witnessing a couple of conversations, and then you're having your own, maybe a couple of conversations about how do I pull this person out of this, how do I anchor this person. And so it's a very active space. It can be, you know, agitating, but it's also, like what I hear in what you're saying is that you learned to be witness to the more fulsome story, so that maybe you can care for giving that person a rest from some of that really active and agitating conversation that they're having. And like for me, it's so exciting to hear, to not dismiss somebody as just a bunch of gobbledygook, because that's what dominant culture has taught us to do.
Right.
And that's been so harmful to our people, because so much of what our people do is just gobbledygook, right? Like when we care for the land, it's just gobbledygook because it doesn't mesh with the colonial agenda. When we talk about looking after our kids and our women, it's just gobbledygook because, sorry, there's no way to fix that, right? And so to listen to the more fulsome story is so exciting to me. Oh yeah, and it's also about cultural differences, and it's about language, and it's about intention. It's so many things. Maybe that's our next episode.
So many things. Yeah, it's so many things.
Part of what we both experience, and part of what so many people experience, is when do we get a chance to touch down into the really rich terrain of these conversations? And so what are often floating around thoughts and ideas, unless we're like doing deep dives, like maybe in the academy or maybe as like some kind of community initiative, we're not in really rich terrain. And so we're in our lives, right? And so then when we get to like sort of float around in these conversations, we're like, hey, we started 50 things and holy, there's so much. And so this has been a very fun conversation. And I feel like I'm leaving very energized with, oh, there's so many things we get to talk about, and also inspired to go and keep having these conversations. And I've got to say, Jenna, I'm just totally inspired by you and the way you do your work, and with the grace and the humility that you bring to it.
Thank you.
Yeah. So thanks for coming and doing this with us.
Thank you for the invite. I love these kinds of conversations.
So that wraps up our conversation with Jenna Breuer. In our next episode, join us as we visit with Wendy Stevens.